Hi friends, welcome back to our channel Arnav Tech Solutions. After a long time, I'm going to post a new video on the cluster configuration. It's really been a long time I have come online and posted anything. Had been quite occupied in travels across the globe for various technological and implementation parts. Met really some very beautiful and some very lovely people across Africa, Middle East, and the Gulf part. So here we are again, going ahead with our cluster configuration video that shall be dealing with the SuSE 12 Service Pack 3 high availability cluster configuration. In this video, I'm going to use in a setup which is based on three virtual machines built over the SuSE 12 Service Pack 3 environment, where in one machine I'm going to use as my iSCSI targets for preparing in my SAN environment. And then I have two nodes which will be used up for my two node high availability NFS cluster there. In SuSE environment, there are slight changes as compared to when you talk about the Red Hat platform. Like in Red Hat says that using GFS2 is a better solution for building in the cluster environments and for building in your distributed file systems, which shall be used for the concurrent access. Whereas when you talk about the SuSE clusters environment, so SuSE says, or the novel environment says, if you want to focus upon the performance of data delivery, then you should go on with the OCFS2 file system. And if in case you want to focus upon your concurrent read and writes and those things, but performance is not the major concern, then in that case, GFS2 is a suggested solution. In SuSE environments, the official documentations, they say that we should prefer to use OCFS2 file system as compared to the GFS2 file system. They have their own reasons behind that, because SuSE is generally used for your SAP deployments, SAP HANA deployments and all. So wherein the fast reads and fast write operations are more required. So which sometimes in comparison to OCFS2, GFS2 lags a little bit behind that. Okay. So generally when we build in our high availability cluster, so herein I have my high availability cluster diagrammatic representation for you. So we are going to use these three nodes, where one of the node I have configured up as my sandbox. We'll be using in YAS2 service for configuring this to publish my block devices over the network. Then I have node 1, which shall be initiating my cluster configuration, and then node 2, which I will be joining later on to my cluster defined on here. Okay. And I have used 4 network paths, 2 for my SAN access. I'm going to use this blue channel. This is my bonded channel here. So I'm going to use in my bond interface. In spite of creating in a multipath environment, I'm creating in a bond environment. So some of you may say that I could have created a multipath channel and I could have used multiple paths to access that. But here I'm preferring in place of using multipathing, I'm preferring to go on with the bonded interface. And I'll be connecting to my SAN over this bond channel, so that even if in case one of my link is down, still I have the high availability path there. Okay. Then I'm using in one channel, which I'll be using in for my heartbeat communication. And this is going to be my multicasting. I'll be using an IP address of the range 239, sort of a private address for the multicast blocks. And then we will be using in one interface for our client access channel. Okay, so generally for my cluster building, there are some prerequisites that I must have in my infrastructure so that the cluster services do not fail and the cluster services do not cause a lot of issues when you are building in the cluster. So first and the most important requirement is that each and every cluster member must be capable of resolving the others by name. So in real-time production scenarios, you would be having a dedicated Active Directory server or a novel directory server, or it could be your IBM Identity Manager. You could be using any particular product there. As here, I don't have a dedicated domain or Active Directory controller. So what I'm using in, I'm using here my hostname resolution using the /etc/host file. So I'll be replicating the same file across all the cluster node members. Second requirement that we have in our cluster building is that all my cluster nodes should be able to connect to each other without providing in the passwords. That is, they require the passwordless authentication. Sometimes you also call it up as a seamless authentication. So here we are going to configure in our cluster building deployments SSH2 protocol for building in my passwordless authentication, keyless authentication you can call it there. And then for my cluster nodes to have the proper Corosync updates or for having the proper distributed locks management on there, it's very necessary that all my cluster members, they are time synchronized. They must present the same time updates. The clock must be set, clock must be synchronized there. So for my clock synchronization, we are using in our NTP or crony services in case of your SuSE 12 or in case of your Red Hat 7 or your Ubuntu 16 and Fedora 27 environments and all. On Red Hat, you can select any of the two. It doesn't matter at all. But SuSE is a little bit sticky towards the NTP service. So even if in case you have configured a crony service here, the SuSE environment or the SuSE pacemaker cluster deployment, what you have into the /12 environments and the Hawk 2 environment, but still after having the crony configuration, it will ask you that the NTP is not configured and you should continue using the NTP there. So to avoid our warnings and things, if you do not want to have your log files flooded with some warning messages and all, then it's better you stick to the NTP protocol here on SuSE platform. But yes, you can use crony on the CentOS or Red Hat or Oracle Enterprise Linux environments. Okay. And then the third thing we'll be using in the shared storage here. Okay. And in my scenario, I'm going to use for my SAN, node 1 is my IP address 10.1, node 2 is my IP address 10.2, and my client access is over the 10.10.1, 10.10.2, and service IP is 171 for my NFS service access. Okay, so this is just the basics of our cluster environment. As we are building in here a high availability cluster, HA cluster. So let me just give in a quick brief about the three types of clustering solutions that we have. So majorly in production scenarios, you would be building in failover clusters only. If you are worried about the application delivery and all. So majorly we use the failover clusters, also called up as my high availability clusters. Second type of clusters which are more famous are referred up as my NLB. So in case of Linux environments, your NLB clusters could be deployed by using, say, HA proxy solution. You can use in your Nginx for defining your NLB cluster, or you can still stick to your Piranha on the older versions of my Red Hat. Red Hat 5 and Red Hat 6, you have the Piranha clusters there for the load balancing. Okay. And third type of clusters that we have, which we use in for the compute intrinsic applications. Okay. So whenever we are talking about the compute intrinsic applications, in those scenarios, we go on for the high performance clusters. So as our system admins, majorly you would be playing in with the failover clusters only, because generally for NLB, most of the production scenarios, they do go on with the software clusters. They do not go on with the software based high availability, but they stick to your, say, F5, or they stick to your Big IP or your Citrix NetScaler. These are some of the names that you will be using in for your real-time load balancing on the production scenarios. So here our video series is based upon failover, that is high availability cluster configuration, onto SuSE 12 Service Pack 3 using the high availability extension modules available on here. Okay, friends, keep tuned. We'll be catching back soon with the actual demonstration of this cluster part. Okay, so keep tuned. Thank you. Thanks for joining in.